and thank you all for coming. My name is Andrea Burke, and I am a lecturer in the Department of Earth and Environmental Sciences, and I'm a principal investigator in the new Isotope Geochemistry facilities here. I would like to welcome you to our official opening of our event, and I would like to invite you as well to our interdisciplinary poster session after these proceedings. Scotland has had a fantastic history in analytical geosciences with world-class facilities at the NERC Iron Probe Facility at the University of Edinburgh and at Sewark in East Kilbride. And really happy to be joining these world-class facilities and to have members from these institutions here with us today. We also have members from throughout the UK at leading research institutions in isotope geochemistry, and we're really happy to be joining this already fantastic community of isotope geochemists. Now, the first part of today is by far the most important, and that is a massive thank you to all of the people who've been involved in making these laboratories a reality. And it's so important that I have a cheat sheet of all of the names of people that I need to say, like I'm at the Oscars.
You only give me 45 seconds.
Yeah, I know, exactly. They're going to start playing the theme music to get me off the stage. First and foremost, we'd like to thank the University of St. Andrews, the University Court, and the principals, members of the principal's office, both past and present. We'd like to thank Professor Gary Taylor, acting principal of the university, who's going to be doing our official opening here today. We'd like to thank Professor Neville Richardson, former master of the university, who was master when these labs were constructed. We'd also like to thank Professor Derek Willens, who is VP of Research here at St. Andrews, and who played a key role in the development of these laboratories, and who's also provided support for our events today. We would like to extend thanks to Professor Peter Clark, who's been an enthusiastic supporter of our vision in the Department of Earth and Environmental Sciences. And finally, we'd like to thank Professor Chris Hawksworth, former VP of Research at St. Andrews, for his instrumental role in recent developments in geosciences at St. Andrews. We would also like to thank additional funding sources as well, including NERC, who funded our capital equipment grant for a Thermo Fisher Neptune Plus multi-collector inductively coupled plasma mass spectrometer, or MCI-CPMS. That is the last time I will be saying it out in its full form. This instrument complements the two new plasma mass spectrometers that we purchased from ETH with funding from the University of St. Andrews. We're grateful to the sales reps and engineers from both New Plasma and Thermo Fisher, who have done a fantastic job in helping get our machines up and running and generating great data. Funding for today's event comes from EPSRC and Thermo Fisher, and we are very grateful to be able to bring together researchers from across the UK and from across the sciences to discuss and forge interdisciplinary collaborations. We'd also like to thank all of our colleagues in the Department of Earth and Environmental Sciences. It's been an absolute pleasure joining the team here. It's been a lovely department to join, and we really appreciate all of the support that they have given us and these labs over the past few years. In particular, we need to thank Tony Prave and Ed Tipper for their really Herculean efforts in getting this project up and running. Tony likes to claim that he is a field geologist who does not know a mass spectrometer, one side of a mass spectrometer from another, but actually he has been an absolute rock of support for this project. And Ed Tipper is typically referred to in our lab as St. Edward for his tireless efforts to make these labs really world class. Finally, we'd like to extend a thank you to a number of people who support the laboratory and our research efforts with their work and effort on a daily basis. The chemistry department has been very welcoming to us geoscientists, geochemists, and we're particularly grateful to Sylvia Williamson and the chemistry and physics workshops for all of their help. We also owe a massive thanks to our lab group to have been fantastic in doing the many jobs to get these labs up and running, and they've been an absolute joy to work with over the past few years. We'd like to extend a special thanks to our research officer and lab manager, Dr. Dan Mietze, who has worked tirelessly to get our machines producing beautiful data, which they are. And finally, a very, very special thanks goes to Dr. John Smith from the Department of Chemistry. John has looked over this building and our labs within it like it is his own home. And it has been just amazing in his support and help in getting these labs up and running. All aspects of this project, John has been involved in, from design through construction to day-to-day looking after the air handling units and the filtration units, and we really wouldn't be where we are today without his efforts, and we really appreciate all that you've done for us. So thank you. So now, without further ado, I thought I would show you a quick virtual tour that our lab officer has put together for us, which is great that it's not showing up on the laptop, so I'll have to do it through this. So our clean laboratories, why do we need clean laboratories? And the reason is that we typically are measuring very, very small differences in very, very little stuff. And so we cannot have any dust. So a single particle of dust will ruin your measurement. And so we have to have very clean labs. And really, the engine behind all of this is not in the labs themselves, but it's in the air handling units, which you can see displayed here. It's quite a lot of engineering went into these. And their main purpose is to blow lots of very clean air through filters to prevent any particulate matter. So we have two sets of air handling units, one for the mass spec lab and one for the clean chemistry lab, which we can go outside and have a look at. This was going to be very useful in case it was actually pouring down. So we've been lucky with the weather, but just in case, wanted to show you the air handling units. And it's really the engineering of these that makes our labs really special. The balance, keeping our labs overpressured so no dust and dirt comes into them when you open the door, and providing all of that clean filtered air. Now, one of the elements we really were interested in measuring is boron isotopes. And because it's useful in tracking carbon cycle changes in the past. And it turns out boron is in everything. In particular, the filters that people typically use to make clean labs, which are made out of borosilicate glass. And so our lab has been completely designed from the ground up to be absolutely boron free. We have Teflon filters. And to my knowledge, I think this is the first lab in the world that has done that. This is reflected in our excellent boron blinks, and if anyone wants to know any more about that, I'm sure James will love a captive audience at the poster session afterwards. Now, everyone take a deep breath of air. Now, that sort of cubic foot of air typically has about a million particles that are greater than 0.5 microns. Our clean labs were designed to be class 10,000, which means that they were going to have, in a typical cubic foot of air, they're going to have 10,000 particles greater than 0.5 microns. Now, the engineering and design was so fantastic in our lab that actually our labs turned out to be class 100, so several orders of magnitude better than what we were expecting. And that's just great. It means our labs are very, very clean. Okay, so now let's have a look at what these beautiful labs look like, go into our airlock. Now, clean labs, I won't call them a dime a dozen, but they have been developed for a lot of different industries, in particular the semiconductor industry. But with most clean labs, you don't have to worry about toxic chemicals and fumes. Because we're geologists dissolving rocks with very nasty acids, we need to also have extraction. And so it's this balance between overpressuring a lab with clean air and then also having extraction out to remove the toxic fumes. And so we have a series of airlocks and pressure cascades to ensure that we're keeping the labs clean and still removing the fumes. And so you can go into the first airlock here, and this is at negative pressure relative to the hallway, so no toxic fumes if anything were to break or to go out into the hallway, which is good for passersby. And then we go into the second airlock here, which leads into the entrance to the two clean labs. We have two mirror images, and then these ones are overpressured, so when you open the door, you won't suck in dust and dirt from the outside. So this is our beautiful clean lab. You can see it's very clean. Our labs, our grad students and postdocs work very hard to get it up and very organized. And you'll see here those are laminar flow hoods, so that's an extra added level of cleanliness. So the air in those laminar flow hoods see an extra layer of filtration, and that allows us to, that's a space where we can purify and prepare samples for analysis. And I will now show you, after the samples are cleaned and prepared, we can bring them into the clean mass spec lab, which is also class 100. And you can see here we have two of our multi-collector ICPFSs, a Thermo Finnegan Neptune Plus and a New Plasma. And the way that these work is that your sample gets ionized by plasma, which is a little bit of the sun, then it gets accelerated over a voltage and makes the ion beam is made to bend a corner, and that is allows us to separate out the isotopes by mass. And you can simultaneously measure your ion beams, which gives you the really high precision that we're looking for our applications. I've mentioned that we have three multi-collectors. You'll only see two in this image. That's because the third one is destined for a new lab across the hall, which is going to be our laser ablation laboratory, which will have the second new plasma MCICPMS and an Agilent ICPMS as well. So stay tuned, watch this space, more developments to come. So with that, these are not the only mass spectrometers we have. We also have, we also have a gas source laboratory right next door. And these labs, these machines are really, really great as well. And in contrast to the MCICPMS, we're measuring metals and metalloids. So a lot of those elements in the middle of the periodic table here. The key is in the name, it's a gas source mass spectrometer. So you're measuring isotopes that you can measure as a gas in its gaseous form. And these ones in particular are set up for sulfur hexafluoride measurements and selenium chloride measurements. And these are unique in the UK. And they, we also have a custom-built, in-house, handmade fluorination line as well to prepare samples. And we're really lucky to be having Ava Stoiken join us from University of Washington, and she's going to be heading up this lab. Unfortunately, she can be here today, but she's really looking forward to getting this up and running. So I've talked a lot about the analytical capabilities, but really the lab is only as good as the research you're doing in it. And to sort of move us on to the questions we're going into, I'd like to introduce you all to my colleague, James Ray.
Right, thanks very much, Andrea, for the great introduction to the labs. Thank you all very much for coming. So we've heard about these amazing facilities. Like Andrea said, you know, they're only as good as the kind of questions that you're going to go after with them. And we're really lucky, I think, in the earth sciences that we get to go after absolutely amazing questions. You know, the kinds of things that get you excited about science when you're at school. You know, like where did the planets come from? Why did the dinosaurs die out? But also the kinds of things that are incredibly societally relevant as well. Questions like, you know, how does climate change work? What climate states can we see on our planet? Where can we find natural resources and how can we use them responsibly? And isotope geochemistry has proved an incredibly powerful tool to go after some of these questions and provide really first order answers to them. So it's been an incredibly exciting time in the earth sciences, largely spurred on by isotope geochemistry. And we're really lucky that that exciting time in the earth sciences has also been mirrored, if you like, by an exciting time in the earth sciences right here at St. Andrews with the real kind of growth and development of our department. And we're really, really grateful to the university for their vision and support in driving our department forward. So we've got this whole range of potential applications that we can use isotopes for. And at STAiG, we're trying to go after a nice range of these. And so in the rest of the talk, I'm going to take you through some of our main research themes and some of the people who are involved in working on this. And this is a lab that, you know, is headed up by a few of us, but really that serves a whole load of members of our department, and also that we're very keen to be put to good use within the university more broadly. So, to begin at the beginning, how did Earth evolve from a mass of dust and gas to the planet on which we live today? I mean, that is just the most wonderful, profound, kind of fundamental question. And it just, you can't help but get excited by that. And that is, you know, a sphere of the geosciences that Paul Savage, who's one of our lab PIs, is very keen on thinking about these origins of the planets, the building blocks of the solar system. And we're really very, very lucky to have Paul join us at the end of this month. So, you know, some highlights from Paul's research, for instance, have been looking into the very building blocks of the solar system and the things that really make up the very deepest parts of our planet. So Paul, for instance, has recently used the isotopes of copper to think about what elements, and in particular what life elements, are in the Earth's core, right in the very centre of the Earth. Moving slightly out of the very centre of the Earth, we've got an excellent team looking at questions through the mantle. Sammy McHale, who's also recently joined us, for instance, has been looking at the formation of diamonds at the base of the crust, again using isotope geochemistry. And Peter Kaywood, our head of department, has used isotope geochemistry in a variety of ways to study the continental crust and patterns of crustal growth and destruction. So, moving from the insides of the Earth to the outsides, the fluid envelopes, the ocean, the atmosphere, and the climate system within them. Here we're interested in questions, and really this is just one that fascinates me, how did CO2 change in the past? And how did climate change along with it? You know, we have, in some ways, all of the experiments, almost all of the experiments on Earth's climate have been done in the geological past. We can go back into that geological past to find out more about how our climate system works. For instance, you know, what was the CO2 level the last time that there wasn't an ice sheet on Greenland, which would have a sea level 5 meters higher than today? Or the last time there wasn't an ice sheet on Antarctica? And I'd really encourage you at the poster session to go and look at the poster that our postdoc Rosanna Greenup has put together, which shows some really nice reconstructions of atmospheric CO2 over the last 25 million years, and actually shows, kind of alarmingly, that the levels today, 400 ppm, are really unprecedented in that time frame. So we're interested in CO2 and climate, but we're also interested in a whole lot of different aspects of climate. You know, for instance, the interaction of the solid Earth with the climate system. Andrea's been doing some really interesting research using trace levels of sulfur and its isotope composition in ice cores to look at the volcanic forcing of climate and reconstruct explosive volcanism over the last couple of thousand years and its volcanic forcing of Earth's climate. We're also really lucky in St Andrews to team up with a great marine biology department, and we're very excited about the new developments at the Gatti Aquarium, and we're really keen to keep thinking about how ocean circulation relates to the living things within the ocean and how that has changed over geological time. So speaking of living things gets us to our next theme, geobiology and biominerals. Here we're really dealing with biology on a massive scale, massive spatial and time scale, and dealing with the interaction between biology and life and the co-evolution of that life with the evolution of the planet. One topic that we're really interested in and that Mark Clare, our colleague, has had recent funding from the ERC for is what was the composition of Earth's early atmosphere? For instance, you know, how did our planet become oxygenated? It's this very strange thing about our planet. It's full of oxygen. How did that happen? And Mark's keen on using sulfur isotopes and selenium isotopes to dig into that question in more detail. We've also been looking at questions ranging from the dawn of complex life, which our colleague Tim Robe had an incredibly interesting paper on out a couple of weeks ago, and then teaming up to think right into the present about what's the modern interaction between marine life and its environment as the ocean rapidly acidifies. And I'd like to give a shout out to Nikki Allison, who has this absolutely amazing coral culturing setup where she's been culturing corals under different CO2 conditions, and we can then look at the chemistry of those corals to better work out how those skeletons get made and how vulnerable they might be to ocean acidification, which was the topic of a great workshop here earlier this week. So, one of the major applications, something a bit more applied within the earth sciences, is our natural resources. And to just kind of bring this home, I always like this way of thinking about this. If you look around this room, or any room, you know, if you see something and you couldn't grow it, a geologist had to find it, you know? It's a kind of staggering thought. And earth sciences and analytical and isotope geochemical earth sciences are still very much involved in the exploration for and responsible use of Earth's natural resources. So some of the topics that we've been looking at in particular are the supplies of rare earth elements. Adrian Finch has a proposal funded to look at rare earth element sources up on Greenland. And going from minerals to water, and water and heat, Ruth Robinson's been doing some really interesting work on geothermal heat and has been instrumental in setting up this really fantastic geothermal heat project in the Guardbridge site just outside town, which we're really excited to see how that comes along. So those are some of the kind of more geological applications of our lab, but in some ways, you know, underpinning all of those and underpinning the science we want to do here more generally is, you know, just analytical development and capability, and that applies not just to the geosciences, but across the sciences as a whole. You know, we're very interested to continue to make new tools that we can use in earth sciences. You know, can we refine our geochronometers? Can we make new traces for the climate system or for the building blocks of planets? But we also want to push isotope geochemistry and isotope chemistry, if you like, into broader fields and get new people involved in thinking about this exciting science. And so one of the exciting ways that we're going to do that, we have this new master's program kicking off this year, the MSc in Geochemistry. And so if you have students, be they chemists, biologists, or geologists wanting to enhance their geochemical skills, please send them our way. But really, you know, to kind of finish off, it's great to be here sitting, you know, with our labs within the chemistry department, because it really does open up the room for conversations about the kinds of things that we can do. We've already started working with John Irvine and his group on fuel cells, and Richard Baker looking at trace elements in ceramics. And really, I mean, here's the potential, right? There is the periodic table. It's up on the wall of the chemistry department here. But I guess I'd encourage you to look at that a bit more like an isotope geochemist. And within each and every one of those boxes, you get to see just so much richness and potential information that's waiting to be unlocked in isotopic fingerprints. So please, if you're interested in any of our capabilities at all, any of the things that you might have heard about today, do have a chat with us at the poster session, or drop me an email, come and knock on the lab door, or ring our special Wi-Fi doorbells anytime. We were interested in making measurements across a variety of things on the periodic table, and we already have a good number of them set up and running. So thanks very much, and thanks again for coming along.
I'd like to now introduce you to Professor Peter Kaywood, who is the head of department in the Department of Earth and Environmental Science.
Thank you, Andrea. What a wonderful and exciting day. And I'm not just talking about the weather outside. For once, very, very nice and sunny. But look, it is fabulous to see these labs come to fruition after many years of work and effort by lots and lots of people. And I thought what I'd like to do, and I want to be brief, is just give a bit of philosophy about what we've been doing over the last couple of years here and how it's turned out in terms of the success we see here today. And I suppose one of the things we've tried to do in this period of what is really unprecedented growth in the department in terms of staff, in terms of undergraduates, and luckily in terms of research income to allow us to move forward with our research, But what we've tried to do is expand, but you know, maintain what we did well in the past, which was classic field-based training of Earth scientists for industry and for academia elsewhere, but also to now expand into the environmental sciences and into geochemistry and isotope work, as Andrea and James have beautifully alluded to. And part of that has been encouraging and employing young, keen, outstanding academic staff. You know, not too many boring old farts like me, thank God. We've really emphasised on young people, and you've just got to see the enthusiasm that Andrew and James have brought to their presentations here, that they bring to their teaching, and that they bring to their research, which really, I think, stands us apart in the way we've tried to expand over the last few years, and not only employ outstanding young people, but also give them the resources, the labs, which you'll see later on, to achieve their scientific goals and to move their careers forward. And so I think the success of today, having you all here and just seeing people like James, Andrea, and all the other new staff we have, I think is a real mark of the success that we've achieved there. I'd also just briefly like to reiterate some of the thanks that Andrea has made to various people. We wouldn't be standing here today, or sitting here today, in the Purdy building, if it hadn't been for a conversation that I had with Derek Woolens when he was head of chemistry, about the possibilities of closer interaction between earth sciences and chemistry. And he was embraced that and incredibly enthusiastic to move that forward. And so offered a space in the building to develop our labs, and we're immensely grateful to Derek for that. But as you can see from Andrea's virtual tour, it wouldn't have been possible to shoehorn us in here without the necessary detail and support that allows the development of such labs. And John Smith, as Andrea's already alluded to, was fundamental in terms of achieving that. They talk about London taxi drivers having the knowledge. Well, John has the knowledge of the North Hoare and the Purdy building in particular, and without his knowledge, without his involvement in every aspect, it wouldn't have been possible. You've also seen that clean labs are bright and shiny, not lots of white coats of paint and people dressed in white coloured overalls, but it's more than that. It takes a hell of a lot of planning, a hell of a lot of detail, to achieve the kind of blanks and the air handling systems that Andrea talked about. And oh, perfect timing. Who should walk in the door but Ed, but St. Ed? Ed to and so none of this would be possible in terms of what's been achieved without literally the blood, sweat and tears that Ed has put into designing the labs, to redesigning the labs, and bringing it all together. So we're incredibly grateful to Ed, doubly so, because once the labs were finished, before he'd even got a chance to use them, he piddled off to some funny little university down south that we won't even bother naming. And you can also perhaps gather by looking at Andrea's tour that these aren't just white walls and a few little boxes inside. They're incredibly complex, but more importantly, they're incredibly expensive bits of kit, not only the instruments that are in them, but also just building the labs themselves. And so they do cost a lot of money. Perhaps it's a bit like, they say yachting is an expensive sport, where, you know, they give the analogy, it's like standing under a shower tearing up 10-pound notes. Well, I think the building and the vice principal would probably agree with this. It's not tearing up 10-pound notes, it's tearing up 100-pound notes, probably. But I think, perhaps to extend that analogy, you don't get the benefit after you've done all that of lazing about in your budgie smugglers or bikini in the sun. You're stuck in a dark room or a room without any window in funny penguin suits. So it does take a lot of time and effort, and particularly support. You know, if you're going to do this over a number of years, you need the support at the highest levels of the institution. And we have been incredibly lucky in the support that we have received from Neville Richardson and Chris Hawkesworth when they were here. They had this vision that we wanted to create a 21st century earth science department, and I think through that support we have done it, and through the continuing support and ongoing support from the senior members of the principal's office, we've been incredibly fortunate in what we've achieved. Hopefully our new principal will be equally supportive. But perhaps that's a nice segue into now calling on Gary Taylor, the acting principal of the university, to formally open the labs here. So Gary. Okay.
Thank you. Good. Well, thank you for inviting me to do this. I'm not an earth scientist, and I was trying to think how I might start talking about earth science, but it took me back to a memory about 20 years ago. We used to live near Bath, and my wife and I would go walking along the remains of the Somerset Coal Canal. And there's a village there called Monkton Coombe, and there's a cottage in the village. And on the wall of the cottage is a plaque which says the father of English geology. Now, anyone know who that might be?
Smith.
Brilliant. I'm in the right place. So you're right, it was William Smith. And I'd never forgotten that. And I read up about him. He was employed to help dig the canals in the Oolitic limestone of that region. And he became fascinated by the fossils that he saw there. And so he started an interest in geology and so on. And he created, apparently, the first geological map of the UK. Is that correct?
Yep.
But I always wondered why he was called the father of English geology until I came to Scotland and discovered actually the father of geology is James Hutton. And then, of course, he was the year he died, he was followed by Charles Lyell, who was born the year that Hutton died. And I knew Lyell not from geology, but from biology, because he was a great friend of Darwin. And a lot of Lyell's writings on the origin of the Earth influenced Darwin's thinking about evolution. And so I'm trying to find every possible segue, as you can understand. So, but what it tells me is that from the very beginning, Earth Sciences was an interdisciplinary science. Both from Smith and Hutton and Lyell, they were not frightened to cross boundaries between earth sciences, geology, biology, chemistry, physics, and so on. And we see it so today. I like to think of myself as an interdisciplinary scientist. I was a physicist, mathematician originally, be turned into biology. And so it's lovely to see earth sciences sort of carrying that torch for interdisciplinarity, and St Andrews is a great place to do that. So what you've seen is a truly world-class facility, and I recognise this because I was involved in recruitment of EVA recently, and we had a stellar number of applicants for that job who came from Caltech, MIT, Yale, University of Washington. They were superb, and they'd all been attracted here because of the world-class facilities, which are almost unique in the world. And we've got a fantastic set of young academics that were appointed here, and the huge investment that you've alluded to is paying off. We're seeing fantastic grants being won by these people, and we're seeing fantastic publications being produced by them. So I think the future is very rosy for interdisciplinarity in earth sciences at this university, and I wish you all the best. So with that, I now attempt to pull the curtain. So I declare STAiG open.
Another principal investigator in these labs.
Well, hello everyone. It's my great pleasure to introduce Professor Alex Halliday to give the inaugural lecture of the St Andrews Geochemistry Laboratories. There's very few more apposite than Alex to attend and give such a talk to such an event. He has, through his very wide and successful career, basically been at the forefront of isotope measurements and applications to all facets of the geosciences, and as I hope he will allude to in his talk. A bit of history, he finished his PhD in 1977 at Newcastle in the physics department, and then he moved and spent 10 years at East Kilbride, which was then the Scottish University's Research and Reactor Centre, which has now lost a reactor, but has got an environment. So it's now the Scottish University's Environmental Research Centre, but there he worked with, among others, our very own Ed Stevens, on looking at applying stable isotope techniques to understanding granite formation, granitoid formation in Scotland, in Ireland, and across the world. And it's great to see as well so many people from Swerk who's come over from today to visit. After he left East Kilbride, he went over to, and he became a professor at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor. He broadened his applications of isotopes even further, going into paleoceanography, paleoclimate. And in 1992, he was one of a few scientists who recognized in a new mass spectrometer the potential for its application to the geosciences. That was the multi-collector inductive leak-up. We've lost it now, but we did have a picture of two of them behind me. The multi-collector inductively coupled plasma mass spectrometer, and he took delivery in 1994 of the very first of those pieces of instrumentation, the P54, and in 1995 published the very first paper, as well as, in my opinion, the most exciting, one of the most exciting things he did was to apply the hafnium tungsten isotope system to looking at the relative formation of the Earth's core and the moon, and all of these fantastically fundamental questions which only with these new insights from isotope geochemistry have we been able to answer. After that, he moved to ETH. He had an extremely successful lab, bought a whole suite of mass spectrometers, two of which we now have in our new, in our new suite. And hopefully, they'll continue to make exceptional measurements. And finally, he moved to Oxford, which is where I met him. He was, for a long time, the head of the mathematical, physical, and life sciences there. He finished that job in 2015.
Oh, yeah.
And now he is the physical secretary and vice...
Vice is good,
Vice president of the Royal Society. He's also a fellow of the Royal Society. He has innumerable awards that could go over, but I think you'd all rather hear and speak. So with that, I'd like to introduce Alex up on stage to give us a talk entitled Isotope Ratio Mass Spectrometry from Planet Formation to Medicine. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much. Really, really great. Wonderful speeches so far. I'm sorry I'm going to let you down. But I'm going to quickly give you a very egotistical view of some of the things that I think are fascinating right now in isotope geochemistry. So it's all about stuff that I'm doing with my group, and it's dominated, when I say doing, it's dominated by the work of the people who actually are really doing the measurements. I'm just sit around helping guide things a little bit. The fact is that isotope geochemistry, as has been alluded to already, has mushroomed phenomenally in the last 20 years as a result of the development of multi-collector ICP-MS. And of course, I've seen that in my own research programs, and many other people have as well. So I'm going to try and touch on some of that. But I thought what I'd do, as well as trying to make it of interest to the general audience, I'd also pose some problems that I'm stuck on that I think are actually really quite interesting scientific problems that we can't really make much sense of right now. So that it's not just about fun stuff. I want to ask you some questions. If you've got any ideas, please let me know. So thing that I have to get used to actually get my head around the right way of looking at this. The important thing to recognize with isotope geochemistry, for those of you who don't know much about it, is that there are sort of three major areas where it has a phenomenal impact, huge impact. First is in the area of isotopic fingerprinting. It provides a sort of forensic tool for figuring out where things come from. And I should have switched this off. Where things come from and the sources of things. The second is in the area of timescales and chronology and time spans.
and rates. And the third is very much in the area of conditions and processes. And these things have been recognized since the 50s and 60s. Great people, of course, great scientists figured out the potential from the point of view of dating back in the early part of the 20th century. But it was Harold Urey in the 1950s who really got people thinking about this last category of how we can actually measure processes and quantify processes by looking at stable isotope fractionations. So let me talk, a quick example of isotopic fingerprinting that I think is mind-blowing. We all know that since Laplace and Kant, that the planets form from a swirling disk of gas and dust that's been known for quite a long time. We can now see those things. So this is a good example in the Orion Nebula. If I try and point at this, this will probably work. If we look in right here at the Orion Nebula, which is just located right there, what you can see is this sort of, in the middle of it, as you zoom in, you start to see some stars showing up, which form a sort of trapezium, which are just around here. And as you go in, you actually see that trapezium getting bigger and brighter. You see this is a big molecular cloud of gas and dust. And as you go further, you can see that as well as these bright, shiny stars, there are these funny things that look a little bit dark and not quite like stars. And if you go right in close to those, these are circumstellar disks. So this is a star, a million years old, and it's got a disk of gas and dust, just like Kant and Laplace predicted. So we didn't know this, although we saw some kinds of disks with a technique called interferometry. They're sort of older disks. These new disks just being formed weren't really visible until we actually had the Hubble Space Telescope doing this kind of stuff. This is an edge-on example over here. Now what's fantastic, really fantastic for all of us, is that we've actually got samples of these dusty disks, which is mind-blowing to me. It's one of the most important things I think that one can actually ever consider as an Earth scientist, is that the majority of the rocks that fall on Earth, there's about 50,000 tons of stuff, maybe it's a bit less than that, but 50,000 tons of stuff that lands on the Earth every year in the form of very fine meteorite material, occasionally bigger ones. So it's a phenomenal flux of stuff. The majority of the stuff that lands is chondritic. That is, it's very primitive. It's rather like the sun in its composition, but without the hydrogen and helium. And if you go into these chondrites and measure their isotopic compositions and see, look at the proportions of different isotopes. Isotopes are made in stars. You find they're pretty much the same as you have on Earth. Not surprising. But nowadays, with fantastically high precision techniques, it's been shown, actually it was shown a few years ago, for some elements like chromium and titanium, that actually there are isotopic anomalies in these. And sometimes different kinds of chondrites actually have different proportions of chromium-54, for example, which tells you about some kind of heterogeneity in the dust that actually made up this circumstellar disk that you're now sampling with these chondritic meteorites. Now, if you actually dissolve these things up, which has happened about 25 years ago, 30 years ago, people in Chicago and St. Louis started dissolving big buckets of chondrites and trying to see what was left to try and identify where these isotopic anomalies are coming from, then what you're left with is these amazing grains called presolar grains, which are actually grains of stardust. So in your museum, you've probably got some here in St. Andrews, we've got them in lots of places, you've got chondrites, and inside those chondrites, you've got stardust. And the whole idea that you've got a sample of another star in your hand, I find quite staggering. And you can actually examine it, you can also, under the microscope like this, these SEM pictures, you can also do the isotopic compositions, and you can take a look at what kind of star it was from its isotopic compositions. It tells you. It's the most mind-blowing example of fingerprinting there is. It tells us about the kinds of stars that were around in our part of the galaxy when our sun actually was formed, when it was born, and the stuff that where the debris came from that actually formed our disk. If you look at the isotopes, they're nothing like what you see on Earth. These are the isotopes of silicon, for example. The isotopic composition of all the terrestrial silicon plots right here at the axis with a few per mil variation. We're looking here at hundreds of per mil deviation in the composition of these grains. They don't look like anything formed on Earth. They're formed in different kinds of stars, different stellar environments. We can map those out with these grains, and we can actually test nucleosynthetic models for how stars work in the laboratory. Now, isn't that fantastic? So that's a good example of what you can do. But you can use fingerprinting in other ways, and that's more related to what I've been doing, because you can actually use it to also trace the components in our own solar system. And we can map out the different ingredients in the disk from which the planet's formed. This is an example with titanium isotopes. It's been done to very high precision. Again, titanium was first worked on many, many years ago in the 70s by Jerry Wasserberg and his team, but many others as well at Caltech. Most recently, thanks to multiple collector ICP-MS, we can measure titanium to super high precision. This is a brilliant piece of work by Zhang et al. From Chicago. And basically, one of the important things that they noticed is, and actually this is what they're going after, is the isotopic variations are quite large in all classes of meteorites, but the Earth and the Moon are identical. And this is a really interesting problem because, which has been picked up more particularly with oxygen isotopes, which these are not to do with nucleosynthetic variations, but it's another kind of variation in the disk, where it's been known since the early 70s, work by Bob Clayton at Chicago, that the Earth and Moon are about the same in oxygen isotopes. In 2001, we did a piece of work showing that this was the Earth and Moon were irresolvable down at the 5 parts per million level. There was a paper came out in Science a few years ago from a German group suggesting that maybe there was a small difference, but Ed Young has just produced another paper from UCLA, just produced another paper in Science just in the last few weeks saying actually there is no difference. And this is a remarkable thing because the solar system is heterogeneous. So that actually immediately tells us that the stuff that made the moon is the same as the stuff that made the Earth, or the moon came from outside the Earth, came from within the Earth. That's actually really important because if we hadn't gone to the moon and picked up rocks, actually originally when they were going to the moon, they weren't going to pick up any rocks at all. The whole idea was just to go there, put the flag on the ground, and come back before the Russians did. The whole idea of actually bringing some rocks back, not only would it clearly wipe out the human race, but it was also something that they just didn't have the time or capacity to deal with. And it took a team of scientists in America to actually go to the White House and actually persuade the president we had to do something and actually bring some of these things back. So they brought these rocks back, and it's been an incredibly important archive. I was quite sorry, actually, when I saw the, when they did the sort of the write-ups of the anniversaries of the lunar landings and all this kind of stuff, that actually this wasn't highlighted. But we wouldn't actually have any idea about the origin of the moon right now unless they brought those rocks back, or unless we had some other way of getting them back. Of course, the Russians already got a sampling device. So the important thing about this is that the Earth and Moon are the same, made of the same kind of thing, and we don't actually know how to build a moon because of that. So we have a major problem, so this is one of the problems for you, is how do we actually make the moon? The moon is unusual. It's the largest moon in the solar system relative to the size of its host planet. It's pretty big anyway, but it's actually, in particular, giant in terms of the size relative to its host planet. It carries most of the angular momentum in the Earth-Moon system. It also has a lower density than the Earth. And there have been a variety of theories about this since George Darwin, who was the son of Charles Darwin in the late 19th century, through Harold Urey, who came up with the capture idea. There are a variety of theories about what this might mean. In 1984, there was a meeting in Hawaii to look at this and argue about it. And having brought samples back from the moon, which gave us some other clues about how it may have formed, the giant impact theory was developed, which is that there was the Earth was hit when it was about 90% formed with another planet, which was about 10% of the mass of the Earth. So they two combined, so you've got 10% of this other planet, 10% of you is this other planet. Basically, the glancing blow provided the angular momentum of the Earth-Moon system. Now, the problem with this model is that it doesn't actually work from the point of view of the isotopes. So I just told you that the Earth and Moon have similar isotopic composition. Everything else in the solar system is different. Therefore, this planet probably was different from the Earth in its isotopic composition. But when you do the dynamic simulations of the moon-forming giant impact, the ones that seem to work best in terms of dynamics actually produce most of the stuff from the impacting planet. So the moon is actually derived from the impacting planet, not from the Earth. So the atoms should come from the other alien planet and not from the Earth. So this is one of those dynamic simulations by Sarah Stewart that from when she was in Harvard, she came out with a paper in Science. So you're going to see the impacting planet Theia and the Earth. The Earth is green, and the impacting planet is yellow. and you've both got grey cores, and they're going to collide very quickly, and you'll see what happens. So you've got to track what happens to the yellow and the green, basically as a result of this collision. So here you go. You got the. I'm going to have to speed this up. It goes on for a few hours, but anyway. this generates the angular momentum of the Earth-Moon system. In this particular simulation, the Earth was already spinning, but actually in many of the simulations, original simulations, the Earth was static, and it contributed, the glancing blow contributed all the angular momentum. But basically what you can see gradually developing is that you produce a disk of yellow that's dominated by yellow. So most of the atoms that end up in the silicate atoms that end up in the moon actually come out of the impacting planet Theia. So the net result of this is that we have a bit of a problem which we haven't been able to resolve yet. There are probably a paper every few months on this in science, basically bringing out new lines of argument about how you can explain this isotopic similarity between the Earth and Moon while you've got these dynamics that suggest that actually the two formed independently. So Shakespeare figured this out 400 years ago. So you basically got a dynamicist and isotope geochemist talking, and it's not really Othello. And they really were arguing about this, and quite clearly, the problem is that the moon and the Earth are too similar to each other in terms of their geochemistry, and it's driving us all mad. Okay, so let me talk about timescales quickly, give you some examples of that. This is something I'm going to whiz through because I'm not going to talk about much about chronology. I really want to get onto the third subject. But timescales have been incredibly important, and there are the long-lived nuclides in the solar system which have got half-lives similar to the age of the Earth, those kinds of billion-year timescales. And then you've got these short, the ones in blue are the ones we mainly use in geochronology. And then you've got these short-lived ones, which are now extinct. We call them short-lived. They've got half-lives ranging between 100,000 years and 100 million years, but that's short in terms of geological timescale. So the parent is now completely extinct after 4.5 billion years of evolution, but we can measure the daughter and the variations and the abundance of the daughters, and it tells us we can only produce those variations really early on in the solar system. So you can actually, you only have a time window that's quite small and finite for actually defining when you can produce those isotopic compositions, which means you've got an incredibly powerful way of looking at time right at the beginning of the solar system. So this has been immensely important. I won't go through the whole detail of this, but now, you know, over the last 20 years, we've actually put this together pretty much. Some of it was figured out fairly early, but large parts of it have really only become clear in the last 5 to 10 years. Partly using tungsten chronology, and the stuff I've got here is partly my work, but a lot of it's a lot of work of other people as well, and much more precise uranium lead chronology and aluminium 26. Even if we didn't know about isotopes, we wouldn't even have a way of dating Saturn, so it's kind of cool that we've got this. If we hadn't actually measured meteorites, we wouldn't know the initial abundance of aluminium 26 in the solar system, which is used to figure out the age of Iapetus, the moon of Saturn. Because of the amount of Iapetus, if you know it, basically has a sort of icy cracked, it's not quite like Europa, but it's got a massive crack on it, which suggests it heated up slightly and then stuck together, and it never really got warm enough to melt properly. And so there's a certain time scale of which you can do that with aluminium 26 heating in the early solar system. So it gives us an age for the moon of Saturn, which means Saturn has to form at least by that time. So Saturn formed really fast. In fact, most of these planets really form fast, except for the moon, which comes out to be quite late, although there's still massive debate on that in the literature. So the whole of chronology is so essential for what we do, and there's plenty of people here who know much more about the more recent more recent timescale chronology, using uranium series, for example, which is immensely important. It's changed the whole of the geosciences completely. So I want to spend most of the time just talking about this last category, processes and conditions, which is something I never used to work in. But with the advent of multiple collector ICP-MS, we opened up the whole periodic table, pretty much, everything that has isotopes, apart from the noble gases, et cetera, which are already accessible, to study. And everyone knew that at some point there must be some finite level of isotopic variation in those elements. but nobody could measure it properly in the small amounts in which they're present in natural samples, like geological samples or waters or things like that. So this has been hugely important. So for those of you who are not experts, this is mass-dependent isotope fractionation. So if you've got some element, which is anonymous element here, with several isotopes shown here of different masses, if you actually do something to it, then like heat it and evaporate it, then at some finite level, the lighter isotopes will respond differently to the heavier isotopes and vice versa. And so you can actually see that and you can measure this mass-dependent fractionation. And that mass-dependent fractionation gives you a fingerprint, if you like, of the processes that have gone on in actually evolving that sample, that rock, that water, whatever. Now, this gives you an idea of what isotope geochemistry was like in the prior to the days of multiple collector ICP-MS. Pre-1995, Oxford, which was very big in isotope geochemistry, was doing neodymium isotopes, lead isotopes, strontium isotopes maybe, and then a little bit of argon dating, and it was doing carbon and oxygen stable isotopes. So this shows you what we've been doing over the last 10 years in red, and it shows you that whole pile of transition metals opening up, for example, and a lot of others. And this isn't unusual. Many labs are doing exactly the same thing. Paul Savage has just been with Fred Moynier in Paris as a postdoc, and you know they're doing the same kind of thing. They're exploring all kinds of different ranges of elements. Same thing is happening in many other great labs. And the excitement of this is that you can actually both explore these elements to actually, because you've got an idea what might be of interest. Something might be biologically utilized, for example. Be really interesting to see what the fractionations are. Others might be particularly interesting because of changes in bonding environment that might be really important. So there are different things you can go after. But in the process, of course, what you do, you go to all the effort to set up the techniques, which may take a good team about 3 years to do. It's a hell of a big job, just to get an artifact-free technique working really, really well and reliably, and then starting to compare with other labs and actually realizing you've got differences, you've got to sort all that out. So it takes a while to set this stuff up for any one element. But once you've done all that work, the last thing you want to do is just to answer one question. You want to go after all the questions you can think of and see what you could potentially do with this technique and have fun. And you get geologists doing medicine, which is kind of where we are now getting to, particularly with Fiona Lana's work at Oxford. She's here somewhere. So we're talking about her now. So let me give you an example of this, my second big problem that puzzles me, and that's to do with core formation. These are, don't worry about this, those of you who are not geochemists won't know this stuff and don't worry about it, but this is basically all the elements in the Earth, apart from the highly volatile elements, in terms of their normalization relative to the average that we have in these things called chondrites, these primitive rocks. And what you can see is that some of these elements like iron and tungsten, these are in the silicate portion of the Earth, the outer portion. So these elements that are things like tungsten and iron and molybdenum are depleted relative to things like lutetium and zirconium because they like to go into metal, so they've gone into the Earth's core. Some of these ones over here are depleted also because, on the left, are depleted because they've gone into, they've been lost somehow because they're volatile. So these ones over here, it looks like the only real reason, they're not volatile, so the only reason for depleting them is really core formation. So if you look at some of these, there are obvious ones down here, like gold, etc. If you took all the gold out of the core and put it on the surface of the Earth, you'd cover the Earth to a depth of about a meter in gold, the whole surface of the Earth. So it's quite a lot of gold down there. So same with platinum and everything else. So basically, most of the stuff's gone down there. There's nothing much left in the silicate Earth. If you look at some of these, it doesn't actually show up here, but if you look at, my pointer is white, okay, there we go. So if you look at some of these, they're slightly depleted. These ones in green, silicon, vanadium, chromium, and then you've got these ones here that are more depleted, iron through to molybdenum. So these iron through to molybdenum, tungsten, they're definitely due to core formation. Silicon, vanadium, and chromium, there's been discussion about whether they're due to core formation, but now there's a pretty strong consensus that that's indeed the case. Now, this is quite interesting because 60 years ago, this guy Francis Birch produced this brilliant paper where he argued that the density of the outer core didn't make any sense in terms of being pure iron metal or iron and nickel. There had to be a light element in there as well. And for the last 60 years, experimental petrologists have been building their careers around figuring out what that light element might be or what combination of it might be. And they just keep going on with it, doing it all the time. So what's cool, though, is that when you actually create a metal and segregate it from a silicate, there's a massive changing in the bonding environment for the elements involved. And so for silicon, for example, you go from an environment where the silicon is in a very stiff bond in silicate to an environment where it's actually floating around in metal in a very different kind of way altogether. So you can actually see an isotopic effect that is produced as a result of that fractionation associated with core formation. So we produced the first piece of evidence for this in 2007. This is work we did at ETH Zurich. Following on from that, there was a massive controversy because nobody believed us, so and lots of people did different experiments, got different results. We've done a lot more work on it. Paul was in the midst of all of this, naively thought he was going to be doing his PhD on something, and then I just said, well, we've got to check out all these numbers. So we actually, Paul and another PhD student, Roz Armitage, basically jointly did the Earth and meteorites to actually check this really was through correct in Oxford. So these are the data for the meteorites. You can see the isotopic composition shown here on the left. So things are, if you go up here, you get more heavy in silicon isotopic composition. These are the various meteorites from both chondrites and small bodies like Mars, etc. If you add in here rocks and the silicate from the Earth, which is what Paul analyzed, these are all from the same lab, measured at the same time. They're isotopically heavier. So the Earth is different from Mars. We've got a heavy isotopic reservoir. Now, there's actually quite some other interesting evidence around this, because other people have done other work since then. Actually, in particular, there's a really nice piece of work being done in Paris by a group there, which Paul Savage got started with, Emily Pringle's work, which actually has shown there are some other rocks out there with heavier isotopic compositions as well. But by and large, this is largely a core formation signal. People seem to be pretty happy with that, and there's experimental evidence to support it. What's really interesting is this is a result of high-pressure core formation, and if you plot the moon on here, you get the same isotopic composition as the silicate Earth. So it's a signal of high-pressure core formation. That means the atoms in the moon must have come out of the Earth, because they were actually fractionated on the Earth by core formation and then transmitted to the moon. You can't actually have the moon just be made of the same stuff. It actually means that you have to have the atoms from the moon actually coming out of the Earth. There's some other examples around that, which I won't go into the details of. So silicon isotopes are providing not just an indication of the light element in the core, but actually providing us with a way of looking at the processes of fingerprinting what's going on with the moon. So let's look at some of these other elements very quickly. I'm going to whiz through them, because if you think about it, if silicon here shows an isotopic effect from core formation, that's only slightly depleted. So these guys here, these are really depleted. They've lost most of their elements of the core. So the residue should be extremely fractionated as a result of core formation. What you'd expect is that if you haven't got much left, it's going to show a big isotopic difference. So a lot of people have been, not just our group, have been pursuing these elements, and we can't do cobalt because there's so many isotopes, but the others, everything has been looked at so far. So let's start with vanadium. Julie Pritchlick did this piece of work, and she's somewhere in the audience, but Julie basically did this amazing piece of work. Vanadium's an incredibly hard thing to measure, and she and Suna Nielsen did this masterful piece of work of geochemistry involving seven columns at that stage. I think it's five now, but getting smaller. But basically, it's a huge, daunting task trying to do vanadium isotopes. The ratio of vanadium 51 to 50 is over 400. So it's actually very, very difficult to get a really precise measurement with such a big difference in abundance. So Julie did the definitive piece of work showing the isotopic composition of the silicate Earth, working with mantle peridotites in particular. And Suna Nielsen measured the meteorites and showed there's a big difference relative to meteorites between what you get for the silicate Earth. This is, so the silicon difference per AMU, per atomic mass unit, is about 0.1 per mil. The vanadium difference, one AMU, even though it's heavier, is about a per mil. So it's a massive difference. And we've done experiments with Bernie Wood, and we can't find any isotopic fractionation associated with metal silicate fractionation at all. These numbers are all zero between metal and silicate. So it looks like there's a big isotopic effect, but it ain't got anything to do with core formation. It must be something else, which is a big mystery. It's a mystery. Right. So let's get on to chromium now. So chromium is the next one, this guy here. This should be slightly more fractionated, and indeed, a really brilliant piece of work by Fred Moynier and his team argued that indeed it was fractionated by core formation. And Schauble did the theoretical modeling of this. We've now remeasured this at Oxford. A number of groups have and found that actually the effect has gone away. So the new work by Pierre Bonan just appeared in EPSL. Basically shows that the meteorites are identical to the values for the silicate Earth. There's no isotopic fractionation, even though it's predicted theoretically. So this is what's going on here. This is really interesting. So what happens if you look at some of these other ones? Well, let's get on to nickel. Nickel is pretty heavily depleted. There is a bit of work that's been done on that experimentally, and it does actually suggest that there won't be any fractionation, but it was done between two solids, so it's not actually that relevant. Anyway, there isn't any fractionation from core formation at all. When you look at meteorites versus mantle, this is Louise Gull's piece of work, which she's got in submission to GCA at the moment. And when you look at some of the other ones, so let's look at molybdenum. It's the most fractionated. We've started work on tungsten, and there's preliminary data from the German group at Munster that suggests there's no isotopic fractionation in tungsten. If you look at molybdenum, people thought there was evidence, and this paper came out a few years ago, where they actually measured it experimentally, molybdenum isotope fractionation between metal and silicate. This is the latest bit of data. It's Crystal from our group, who basically did this piece of work, which is a very, very comprehensive study of mantle samples. There's actually more samples than this, but these are the main peridotites, and there's no real difference between the average of these mantle samples and in particular the mantle peridotites and what you get for meteorites. So there's no, if there is a difference, it's very small. So, and that's something that's incredibly depleted. The molybdenum is the most depleted of these moderately siderophile elements. So there's something funny going on that we haven't quite understood. We should be seeing big isotopic fractionations, and they aren't there. And it could well be that it means it's telling us, it could be telling us two things. It could be telling us either the bonding is such that you just don't get any isotopic fractionation, or it could be telling us that the temperatures were incredibly high during the stage of core formation, so high that isotopic fractionation just didn't happen, because as you get to higher and higher temperatures, then the isotopic fractionation disappears. Silicon could be something else. That could be very, very early, to do with early reduced components from which the Earth may have accreted, because nearly all the silicon is in the silicate Earth. But these other elements are quite sensitive to what happened during the later stages of accretion and core formation, and it could be telling us that this is the giant impact. Very, very high temperatures, several thousand degrees, and the isotopic fractionation disappears. But watch this space. So just to finish off with, I just want to talk about a few other things we've been doing, which are kind of fun, which are working in areas to do with isotopic fractionation. And of course, I have to talk about Paul. I keep talking about Paul. But I've also got the chance here to talk about Gia Yang. Where's Gia? She's here somewhere. There she is, right. Who's one of our former students, and who's like Paul, who's now here as a postdoc. And basically, they've been looking at different isotopic systems in terms of magmatic differentiation. This shows you as a simple volcano, Hecla volcano, the nice, simple, unaltered system. And it shows you that some of these systems fractionate during fractional crystallization, others don't. So that could be quite useful, because some of them means that some of them are going to see through any effects of crystal fractionation. You're going to see the mantle source in a rhyolite, you know, whatever. Whereas others are actually going to tell you about the processes of crystal fractionation. And just like we've always used trace elements together in a combined way to figure out as a fingerprint for what phases were present during fractional crystallization and in the source, you could do the same thing with isotopes. A combined transition metal, silicon, isotopic parameter space that you could actually define things in. So we've started working on this with a few elements and trying to do combined multiple isotopic systems. This is an example of molybdenum, which is supposed to be uniform in relation to cerium in all basalts, molybdenum-cerium ratio. We find that it's quite variable if you go to very small degrees of partial melting, like naphthalenites. And these have extremely light isotopic compositions. So we're not sure why that is. It's a puzzle. But it could mean that it's telling us about a phase that's residual that could be isotopically heavy, which could be something like sulfide in the mantle. So it's providing us with a new fingerprint. Let's leave that. So I need to wrap this up and move on and talk about the oceans a little bit, because we're doing some fun stuff in that as well. We started working on tungsten stable isotopes to do this stuff on core formation, found out quite quickly there was a student working on the same thing as my postdoc was working on, Catherine Abraham. And so we started deciding we should actually get into doing tungsten isotopes in the oceans instead, so that we weren't actually duplicating efforts too much. Now this followed on from a piece of work that Sune Nielsen had done as a postdoc. He originally worked with me at ETH and with Mark Reckamper on thallium isotopes, which Mark and I first kicked off in Michigan a long time ago. So this shows you the kind of quality of records we're getting. And this is these are ferromanganese crusts. They sample metals from the ocean. They're hydrogenous. They grow at a millimeter per million years. And they just pick up very slowly at a millimeter per million years. They pick up the chemistry of the ocean, but they also pick up the isotopic composition of ocean water. Now, sometimes that might be fractionated, and that's part of this interesting story. But also it could be that the ocean itself is changing its isotopic composition. So you end up taking on thallium, which we started looking at, and then decided to do a sort of mass run of lots and lots of samples. And you get records like this, which, again, is one of those gobsmacking moments. When you look at two records like this, these are two Central Pacific seamounts, about 2,000 meters depth. They are both sampling Pacific deep water, and they are both, they're about 3,000 kilometers apart from each other, well away from any continental sources of, and pretty far away from any dust or anything like that. And you get these fantastic changes that are taking place in the ocean since the Cretaceous. And exactly what they mean, we're not too sure. But you say, well, actually, that's got to mean something, you know. So you find these things, you get into them, and you think, well, actually, that must be telling us about an aspect of global change. And if we can characterize it, it's telling us about something that's been changing systematically on the Earth over the last periods of the Cenozoic. So Sune worked very hard on this, trying to figure this out. And I thought it was temperature. He ended up thinking that it was actually burial of carbon, which I think he's probably right. You know, just being able to open up these new archives and say, well, heck, what does that mean? It's just immensely stimulating, and it's opening up the geosciences. So we tried to, given that thallium is one of the heaviest elements in the periodic table, where you would expect to see very little isotopic fractionation at all, but you do, and these are quite big isotopic fractionations, we decided to have a go at tungsten, which is also very heavy, which we can measure to higher precision for a variety of reasons I won't go into. And so we developed tungsten stable isotopes, initially to look at core formation, but we thought we'd have a go at this as well. Now, tungsten's supposed to be quite boring because it's actually got quite a long residence time in the oceans. It's supposed to be quite well mixed. This is a typical profile. There are several profiles that have been done, mainly by the Japanese, and it shows these tungsten concentrations that are pretty much the same all the way down of about 50 picomolars per kilogram per liter. So that suggests that there's nothing removing tungsten from the water column. The residence time is, like I say, about 60,000 years, quite a long residence time. This is what we call a conservative element. It's not being used as a nutrient, nothing's scavenging it. We'd see a big change in the profile if that was the case. So what you'd expect is there ain't anything changing in tungsten in the ocean, so you shouldn't find anything in terms of isotopic changes in this system with depth. So when we started exploring tungsten, what we found, I won't go into the details of this because it goes on too long, but these are the kind of variations we get in other kinds of rocks. And we found the surface scrapings of ferromanganese crust actually distributed showed quite a spread. We were sampling from all over the oceans. And if you plot them versus depth, this is what it looks like. You actually have a pretty much monotonic decrease, pretty much linear with depth in the tungsten isotopic composition. It's a very small effect. It's about 0.1 per mil, 0.2 per mil in these ferromanganese crusts, going from about 500 meters to more than 7 kilometers depth in the ocean. And it doesn't seem to matter which ocean you're in. You've got an effect that's actually increasing. We don't know what's causing this. Actually, there are three of these crusts that have got a slightly bigger hydrothermal component. If we remove these, then that slightly improves the linearity of the data. So we had one seawater sample initially, which looked like it was about the same as the heaviest one here. So we thought, well, actually, maybe these are fractionated, and maybe there's some way in which at increased pressure you reduce the isotopic fractionation. In other words, this is a new geobarometer. So we got incredibly excited. We thought, okay, you can go take iron formations or whatever it is, anything, any oxides back through time, sedimentary oxides, and we'll be able to tell you how much water there was above it when it was laid down. Well, that'd be pretty amazing. Fantastic, be able to sort of explore paleogeography in a new way. So, of course, then we actually measure more seawater samples, and they don't do that at all. They actually do this. They're not constant. We actually are removing tungsten from seawater, or we're doing something to it, because the isotopes in the seawater itself are going all over the place. They're extremely heavy for reasons that aren't clear. There's no component that can actually make them heavy. We have to be removing it. And yet we're stuck with these profiles that are vertical that suggest that nothing's happening. So people like Alex will be able to help me with this. But these are really interesting issues because now we can explore these features of ocean chemistry that nobody knew were there before. And they must be telling us something. We've got to figure out what that is. So there's a couple more things I want to quickly say about tungsten before finishing. One is that tungsten is also quite interesting from the point of view of archaea microbiology. And there's some evidence that tungsten may have been very important as a nutrient before the rise in oxygen in the atmosphere of the Earth. And this is actually endorsed by, if you look at hyperthermophilic archaea, you find that they are quite enriched in nickel and tungsten and cobalt as well. So the suggestion is that actually when there was less oxygen around, the things like molybdenum were actually taken up in sulfides more, so they weren't available, zinc wasn't available, so actually these other elements were more important. And this was proposed quite a while ago by somebody, a very famous chemist at Oxford, who basically suggested this was a tracer for very, very early life. And so you think, well, actually, let's get a work on that. So that's what we're going to do next, is to try and explore whether tungsten isotopes are fractionated by biology, and whether we can actually see a fingerprint of that biological fractionation, and then actually figure out how whether tungsten was being utilized in the very early Earth in the kinds of life forms that we had. In fact, whether we can actually fingerprint very early forms of life using tungsten. So just to very finish completely, this has taken us into biology quite a lot, and my life into biology. But with Fiona Lana in my group, I've been able to do all kinds of exciting new things. And in particular, her work, she's did this brilliant PhD working with Mark Reckamper in Imperial, working as a chemist on biomedicine and cancer in a geology department. Okay, so talk about interdisciplinary, you've got it in spades here. So this is the way the science is going, and you know, I'm now having conversations with colleagues in chemistry and in oncology about how we can take this forward at Oxford in new ways. And this is a really neat piece of work. It shows you've got to be terribly careful. This isn't easy stuff because zinc is everywhere, and it's a very high blank problem you have with a lot of the sampling that normally gets done. So these are both healthy and patients with cancer, a comparison of what you get in terms of zinc isotopic composition in serum. So blue is healthy, and orange is cancer patients. You see the same thing, there's nothing really here in the blood, you can't see any real difference. But when you go to tumors, you can see that you've got extremely light zinc isotopic compositions. So that's really interesting, because it suggests that if you're producing light zinc in a tumor, then you must have somewhere else in the body a heavy reservoir that complements that. And if you could potentially find that heavy reservoir, you could potentially have a new biomarker for cancer. So there's tons more work to be done, so don't get sensationalist about this, even though I am. The fact is, you need to think about whether other kinds of inflammation could also cause the same thing. We need to understand the biogeochemistry, the biochemistry of this in much more detail. So let's be back. Let's leave that. So I want to just finish by saying thank you to my team in particular, who've basically done all this work. It hasn't been me, I just get to talk about it. This is some of them here. There are a few of them, Paul wasn't here. I think he'd moved on by that time to greater things. And of course, thank you to my funding people. But I wanted to close also by saying a few things about St. Andrews. Not because we've just taken your vice chancellor and you've just taken our PVC, but because I think this opening of this lab makes a statement about academic excellence and the health of the UK, I think, which I think is quite exciting. So the first thing I really wanted to say is that these labs, as we kind of heard today, and I think anybody who's built a lab knows, are a huge commitment. I mean, this is not simple stuff. This is not bread and butter, off-the-shelf type instrumentation, nor are the clean labs, anything like that. If you're going to really compete at these levels, you've got to figure out, like we just heard, how do you produce a boron-free lab? When we started doing work in Michigan, we had plastic fume hoods made of a certain kind of plastic, which actually had small amounts of silicon in it. And of course, the next time we were doing work, we realized we've got to build our labs without any silicon in, because we're going to be doing very tiny amounts of silicon, et cetera. It all started years ago when people were trying to measure lead, which used to be a nightmare, and now it's quite straightforward. So this is a massive undertaking. It's just a major commitment by the institution, for which the institution should be congratulated. The second thing is that I think it says something about vision, both from the point of view of the team you've got here, the department, and also the university, that you really want to push to these very, very high levels of excellence. This is tough, cutting-edge stuff where you're going to make groundbreaking discoveries, but it's very risky. You don't really know where you're going with this stuff. You're following your nose scientifically and making all kinds of exciting new discoveries. And I think that takes vision to sort of go down that route. And the last thing it takes is energy. And I think it's been phenomenal to see the people today. And these people have got so much energy. It's so exciting. So I'd like to wish everybody here a tremendous success for the future. Congratulations on opening this lab. And thank you very much.
Already alluded to, I was his PhD student, and you can tell why I've carried on in science, having such a great supervisor with Alex. Would you mind taking any questions?
Oh.
if no one has a question, then that's fine. If anyone has a question.
So these elements that are partially depleted in the silicator, that some of them might have gone into the core, but then don't show any isotope fractionation. So what role would a kind of a late heavy bombardment type addition of those elements have to the isotope ratios that you measure?
So these elements that I've talked about are ones that are present in a high enough abundance that shouldn't be a major effect. The elements that are things like platinum, gold, etc., form the late, what is thought to be a late veneer of stuff that came in after the process of core formation had ceased. They're present at about an abundance of about 0.5%. So it's a very tiny amount. Whereas the effect of that on these particular elements would be quite small. They wouldn't actually play a major role. However, let's just think outside the box. Let's forget the heavy bombardment. Let's think about what the Earth might have been like, because we really don't know much about this. So there's a really interesting paper by a guy called Hugh O'Neill in Australia, who in 1991, he published two big, bold papers in Geochemica, which everybody was sort of a bit gobsmacked by. One was called The Origin of the Earth, and the second one was called The Origin of the Moon. And so basically, at least I think that's right. Anyway, so if you look at his model, it was a brilliant model. He basically said, well, the moon actually is much more like the Earth was prior to the giant impact. and actually it's quite depleted in some of these elements, not entirely. And actually that's turned out to be somewhat wrong over as we got more data on the moon. But the idea was really interesting. He said we'd stripped out all of these elements, so things like molybdenum, tungsten, there wasn't any in the silicate Earth. It was all in the core because the Earth was incredibly reduced, and so everything was going into the core. So all of these elements weren't there in the mantle at all until the giant impact. And then you added this planet to the Earth, and a whole pile of that stuff basically formed the Earth, the silicate Earth. So rather than it just being something that is residue to core formation, the inventory that you've got in the silicate Earth actually represents what came in from that other planet Theia and got dumped into the Earth. And then it wouldn't be fractionated by core formation at all. It would just look like an average planet, if you like, isotopically. So it's a really clever idea. The reason why it doesn't work, one of the reasons why it doesn't work, is that we've since then measured tungsten isotopes in terms of the radiogenic tungsten. And we know that the silicate Earth doesn't have the tungsten isotope composition in terms of radiogenic tungsten that you expect from the chondritic addition to the mantle. Instead, it actually shows the effects of being residual to core formation. So it can't be right, but it's a brilliant idea. And it makes you think, well, maybe there is some partial truth to something like that.
I think we'll wrap it up. But thanks very much, Alex, again for a fantastic talk. We're going to move for posters soon. In fact, now. We're also going to be having some drinks, kindly provided by Thermo. This whole event was made possible by a kind donation by EPSRC. I would want to say thank you very much for everyone for coming today. Hope everyone's had a great time, and we'll see you at the posters. Thanks very much.